Welcome back. I'm your host, as always, Jay Shoob, and we got a good episode here for you guys today. Illinois, coming off a win against Rutgers last week, has a bye week, and they will be going next week to face Minnesota on the road in Minneapolis, and then, of course, they end the season at home against Northwestern, and then Illinois will be going bowling. It'll be just the third bowl appearance in the last 10 years for Illinois. It's been quite some time since Illinois won a bowl game, too. They haven't won a bowl game since 2011. So there's a lot to potentially look forward to this season, but there's still a couple more games in the regular season that we're going to knock out here. But today we're going to talk a little bit of recruiting. We're going to update you guys on what the recruiting board looks like right now. And then we're going to cover some college football. The season is coming to an end, and the college football playoff race is heating up, as well as the conference championship races. Of course, Illinois is 7-3, 4-3 in Big Ten play. They're third in the Big Ten West Division. They're at a point right now where even the biggest Illini homer out there, I don't think, thought that Illinois would be where they are right now. And it's just been a fun ride, and I can't wait to cover the rest of the season here. The last time that Illinois had 7 wins was also 2011. It's just been a time to get a lot of monkeys off their backs. I did not mention that earlier, but when Illinois upset Iowa the other week, it was a snapping a 7-game losing streak. You could see why the fans were all rattled. That was such an important game. That was such a huge game for this program. And that was the type of games that's going to define a coach's legacy right there. They also hadn't beaten Michigan in the Big House since 2008, another accomplishment of David Deal. You just can't speak enough to how well David Deal has done this season, milking the most out of this roster. All right, so now we will get into recruiting. So you can see the board here for Illinois. Looking very solid so far. Illinois has 7 commits. And we're going to start defensively. Starting at the free safety position, Cornelius Taylor right now is in a battle. Illinois just recently took the lead over him. It looked like that Iowa was the favorite to land him, but it's neck and neck. And right now, Illinois is a solid favorite, but that's still coming down to the wire. Quincy Bolden as well is just a lock to commit. It's a matter of when, not if, he will commit. So Illinois looking to hopefully land both those guys. As far as cornerbacks, Brandon Jackson is tight with Old Dominion right now, but he just visited Old Dominion. He's from Maryland, so that's a school in his home area. You can see here he just visited them a couple weeks ago, but he'll be making his visit to Illinois against Northwestern in a couple weeks, so hopefully Illinois makes a good impression on him, and hopefully they can get him to commit. Sean Rogers as well from Oregon. We mentioned earlier that it would be tough to pry him away from the West Coast. UCLA is his top target. He is visiting them next week, and then he'll be visiting Illinois in week 14. But as of right now, the odds probably say that UCLA is the favorite to get him, as he will probably stay on the West Coast. Joe George, of course, a commit the other week. As far as outside linebackers, Patrick Coleman from New York, a 4-star, the number 16 outside linebacker in the country in this recruiting class. He's very solid for Illinois. They imagine he will commit sometime in the near future. Jermaine Mendoza, there's a couple of schools that are in on him as well. Jermaine Mendoza, the second highest priority behind Patrick Coleman at this position group. Illinois is still the favorite to land him, but he just visited Ohio State last week, and apparently they made a really good impression on him. So Ohio State is in the mix with Miami of Ohio, who he's visiting next week, and then of course Illinois. So this Northwestern game will be an important one to make final impressions for these recruits. And then Adam Miller. Illinois is the slight favorite to land him right now. Once again, they're in a battle with Iowa. I'm sure Illinois is using that upset win over Iowa in a lot of their recruiting pitches. Hey, we can beat these guys. As far as defensive tackle, a new commit to the board is Mike Hughes. With Jamal Woods, Calvin Avery, and Deion Pate all leaving this week, or this year rather, Mike Hughes is considered a gem prospect. You can see he's got great blocking, block shedding grades and tackling grades. So he is a great prospect to have, and right now Illinois is his only offer so far. He is doing his recruiting cycle late, And it looks like Illinois and Arkansas right now are the projected top leaders, but there's some other really big schools there on his list. So Illinois doing what they do best, let's go after guys early. And Mike Hughes would certainly be another great addition to this already pretty stacked defensive tackle room. At defensive end, where Illinois can potentially get a multitude of commits here, they already have Joey Church and Ryan Williams in the bank. Wesley Robinson looks really good for Illinois as well. It's just a matter of when, not if, he will commit. And then Chris Williams. Illinois has not offered him a scholarship just yet, but he still is favored to go to Illinois. Not nearly as highly graded as his star rating, but definitely a guy that Illinois could offer and probably land if they wanted to. At center, Lewis Robinson, not Illinois' top target. He committed to Northern Illinois, so he will be taken off the recruiting board. And then Justin Cook already committed a few weeks ago. Illinois is very happy to get him. He was their second option to Reggie Cameron, who went to Mississippi State. So Justin Cook will be very solid for Illinois at the center position. And then at tackle, a position that deeply needs to be addressed in recruiting. Illinois is very shallow at this position. Nate Manson is looking very solid for Illinois. Tom Samuel as well out of Illinois. He was added later to the recruiting board. And so far, Illinois is looking very good to get him. Joe Davis and TJ Williams. Illinois has not offered Joe Davis, but they have offered TJ Williams. They aren't pursuing him too hard because they expect to land at least one of Manson or Samuel. But TJ Williams out of California is another guy that they can go after hard and potentially land. And then at tight end, a new recruit to the board. With Daniel Barker graduating, it leaves open a tight end spot. And Illinois initially wasn't going to recruit this position too hard, but they are going after Corey Evans here very late. He's a very balanced tight end, not really any spectacular grades, but very solid all around the board. He's got a very high floor that can be developed over a few years. So Corey Evans, if Illinois can get him, would certainly be a guy that would sit and probably play later in his career, a long-term development prospect. And Illinois is his only offer thus far. A few big schools on there, but it's very early for him, so we'll see how that plays out. No other schools have really gone after him too hard so far. And then at wide receiver, this is where the most recent slew of new additions to the recruiting board is here. At wide receiver, there's a few new additions, Kenny Harris being the top target of those new additions to the recruiting board. He's a very balanced wide receiver. He's a good route runner. And Illinois has offered him a scholarship. You can see here a lot of big schools are on his list, but they have not gone too hard after him just yet, so we will see where that goes. But Kenny Harris out of Alabama. Brandon Hall has been on the recruiting board from the get-go. He looks like a solid commit to Illinois here in the new future. Richard Dixon, these bottom three wide receivers here are all new additions. Richard Dixon, he's a possession receiver out of Michigan, a three-star guy. Not really any spectacular grades here, but very solid. He's a very good catcher. That's why he is considered a possession receiver. But Illinois has not offered him yet. And Army is his only offer. And right now, Army is the projected favorite to get him. Brent Miller, a four-star wide receiver out of Florida. He's actually leading right now to go to Kent State. But you can see here his grades. He's a speedy wide receiver. Looks like a kind of guy that has the skill set to be a good slot wide receiver or a kickoff returner, as he's got some speed and his return grades are very solid. So definitely a type of gadget player like that, sort of like a Kyron, how Illinois uses Kyron Cumbie. He could be that type of player. And he's got a few big schools on his list. He is a four-star, but not nearly graded as high as his star rating is. And Kent State right now is the favorite to get him because they've pursued him harder. And then Kenny Rogers, another four-star wide receiver out of Michigan. And Kenny Rogers is considered a possession receiver, but he's actually a bit faster than Miller. And he's a very good receiver. You can see his catching grades are very solid, very high floor in the receiving department. And he looks like a guy that's kind of sneakily athletic. And he could definitely be a good outside receiver that's got some speed. And Illinois has not offered him yet. You can see why. He has a list of really big schools there that he's interested in, but no one's offered him yet. And if I were Illinois, I would start going after him a little bit harder. They could certainly afford to land a wide receiver with two of them leaving, Navarro and Hightower. And then lastly, at the running back position, Corey Black. Same story as for the other guys we covered. Corey Black, it's a matter of when, not if, he will commit. You can see Illinois' recruiting class right now is ranked 91st in the country, but it is still relatively early in the recruiting cycle. They still haven't gotten all of the commits that they've been going after. Right now, they have 7 3-stars, and you can see here Darren Robinson, Justin Cook, Joey Church, Terrence Booker, Joe George, Ryan Williams, and Wyatt Anderson, all the 7 commits that Illinois has gotten so far, all 3-stars. But guys like Darren Robinson, they are certainly a 4-star caliber player. Wyatt Anderson as well could be considered a 4-star caliber player. So that's why Illinois' recruiting ranking is pretty low right now. But I'm sure that'll change, and that will rise pretty quickly here as we get towards the end of the season. Okay, so now we will cover the first reveal of the college football playoff rankings in this dynasty. And here we go. Florida is number one in the college football playoff rankings at 10-0. And then you see Auburn there at number two. Florida and Auburn have been neck and neck all season, and they're the only two high-profile undefeated teams left in the country. You can see here Florida's schedule. They have been dominating teams all season. They have a nice win over Kentucky, Auburn, and Georgia as well. Auburn as well hasn't played quite as good of schedule as Florida so far, but they did beat Georgia on the road last week, and they still have to play LSU and Alabama, and they've looked good all season. So these two teams definitely worthy of the top two spots, and they will be playing each other in the SEC championship, so that'll be a hell of a game right there. Clemson as well, they also have a win against Georgia first week of the season. They won at Georgia. They curb stomped number 4 North Carolina 51-17. And their only blemish is a close loss on the road at NC State, who's 4-6. So that's certainly a knock on Clemson. But besides that, they have looked very good against good teams. They've beaten up on a otherwise rather weak schedule. So that's why Clemson's number 3. And then North Carolina is at number 4. North Carolina coming in at 9-1. You can see here they got a win over Baylor at Eastern Carolina, the non-conference. And they did get beat down pretty badly by Clemson, but they rebounded, have beat some solid teams. They beat number 9 Virginia Tech on the road by 10 points. So that certainly looks good. And then a win over Virginia, who's 6-4 as well. And then Oklahoma is coming in at number 5. Oklahoma is coming in at 8-1. And they beat up on Tennessee. They beat Alabama on the road at the beginning of the season. At the beginning of the season, that looked like a really great win, but now it's sort of, Alabama's ranked number 24, so it's still a solid win. They got a win at Iowa State as well, and their only loss is to Texas, who's ranked number 14. But besides that, they haven't really beaten any great. They've beaten good teams, but they haven't beaten great teams. So that's why they're ranked one spot below North Carolina. Washington at 8-1 at number 6. They're beating up on the Pac-12, a nice win on the road at Oregon. They beat number 8 Arizona State, so those two wins certainly look very good. But then they lost last week to Utah at home, and they lost by 20 points. That was certainly an odd game for Washington. Nobody expected them to lose that game in that fashion, so that's what's holding them back right now. But a couple solid wins are on the resume for the Huskies, and they're certainly still in playoff contention. And then the last one-loss team is Iowa. Iowa, of course, has been scoring a ton of points. They have a win over Iowa State. They beat Ohio State at the beginning of the year. And their only loss was to our Illini. I don't know what happened to Iowa. They had a complete meltdown that game, especially in the second half. And that's a bad look for Iowa on the road. Illinois, of course, is ranked number 16 now, so it doesn't look as bad. But you can see here all the one-loss teams. So after the top 7, there's sort of a big drop-off, and then you have these next teams here, Arizona State, Virginia Tech, and Michigan. Michigan has started to rebound. After they lost to Illinois earlier in the season, they have started to pick up their stride, and they've won five straight games in a row, haven't really beaten any spectacular teams. They still do have to play Notre Dame and then Ohio State, which could help them out a little bit. And that win over Utah in week one looks pretty good too, but with two losses, Michigan probably is not in contention anymore for the playoff, but they can certainly win the Big Ten. USC and then Georgia with three losses. Georgia's loss to number one, number two, and number three, you can see here. Poor Georgia lost to number three Clemson, which was very close. They lost to Florida, who's number one, by only 10 points, and they lost to number two Auburn by 15. So you can't really penalize Georgia for playing that kind of schedule. Nebraska is coming in at number 13 at 8-2. Nebraska lost to Miami, who's ranked in a close game. They lost to Ohio State as well. And of course, their best win, believe it or not, is Illinois on the road. But Nebraska's been very solid all year long. They haven't really gotten blown out by anybody, and they play very great defense, so that's why they're ranked where they are. Cincinnati is coming in at number 15. They, of course, beat Ohio State, and they could have been potentially the first group of five team to make the playoff, but then they lost last week to East Carolina. And when you play a group of five schedule, even though it's the American, that's just going to hurt you. And that really killed Cincinnati's chances. They dropped all the way down to 15. And then here's our Illini coming in at number 16 in the country at 7-3. Illinois schedule, they, at the beginning of the season, were playing very close games. That blowout loss to Michigan State there certainly doesn't help. But two wins at number 10 Michigan and then versus number 7 Iowa just look so good for Illinois on their resume. The committee certainly values quality of wins, and Illinois has two solid quality of wins. Two teams that are both leading each of their divisions in the Big Ten. You can see here the rest of the rankings. Ohio State's coming in at number 22. They are jumping back in with four losses. Ohio State certainly having a down year. But look at the teams they lost to at the beginning of the year. They lost to Cincinnati, number 9 Virginia Tech, and then number 7 Iowa. So sort of like the Georgia situation in a little bit lighter fashion. You can't really penalize them for playing that brutal schedule. And then Alabama also coming in at number 24, rounded out by Iowa State. So Illinois ranking ahead of Alabama and Ohio State. Didn't think you'd ever say those words this season. The Big Ten West, as I showed you last week, Iowa and Nebraska will be playing each other last week of the season to decide the division. And Michigan and Ohio State, they will be playing each other last week of the season to decide the division. So almost like two semifinal games for the Big Ten Championship final week. That does not happen very often. That is very cool. And then in the ACC, in the Atlantic Division, it's all Clemson. Clemson already has clinched that division. They will be going to the ACC Championship game. And in the Coastal, right now, it's a race between North Carolina and Virginia Tech. North Carolina looking to get into the playoff. They're ranked number 4 right now. They still do have to play Miami at home and then Duke, but they have that head-to-head win over Virginia Tech, which is certainly going to help them. So Virginia Tech's going to need a lot of help if they're going to get to the ACC Championship game. North Carolina would have to lose one of those next two games, and Virginia Tech would have to win out. So North Carolina with in the driver's seat rather right now. Looking here at the Big 12. Big 12, all these teams still have a couple more games to play. Oklahoma is leading the Big 12 right now. Their only loss was to Texas. So they can't really afford to have another loss on their resume, especially with Texas breathing right down their neck. But Oklahoma looking to become the outright winner in the Big 12, also looking to get into the playoff as well. In the Pac-12, Washington is 6-1 in conference, 8-1 total. They have not quite clinched the division just yet, but all they have to do is beat Oregon State. Yeah, you can see there they still have to play Oregon State. Their only loss last week was to Utah last week. And Washington just one win away from clinching the North Division, looking to go to the Pac-12 championship and potentially the playoff. And then in the South Division, always a competitive division, it seems like every year, USC is leading right now at 6-2. But you can see they have a head-to-head loss to Arizona State in overtime. So that's big because Even though Arizona State is second, they still have the same number of losses as USC. So if Arizona State just wins out their next two games, they are in the Pac-12 championship game via the tiebreaker. So USC is rooting for Arizona State to lose, and that's the situation in the Pac-12. In the SEC, it's all Florida. In the East, Florida beat Georgia head-to-head, so they have already clinched the division. They will be playing Auburn in the SEC championship. And then the West, it's been all Auburn, 7-0 in conference, 10-0 overall. It'll be Florida and Auburn in the SEC championship game. That'll be a hell of a game. And the loser of that game may not necessarily miss out on the playoffs. Now taking a look at the Heisman, Malik Davis for Florida is still the leader for the Heisman Trophy right now. DeMarcus Bowman for Clemson up there as well. And look at this, Keaton Thompson for Virginia is third in the Heisman voting right now. This is a surprise. Illinois, of course, played Virginia in Charlottesville week two of the regular season. And look at this. Touchdown interception ratio is very good. 32 touchdowns to 6 interceptions. Has a 66% completion percentage. And over 3,000 passing yards. That is amazing. Illinois, I don't really recall off the top of my head because that was a while ago. But Keaton Thompson did look very good. That was a high scoring game. But it went into 4 overtimes. And Illinois beat Virginia and Keaton Thompson. That's amazing. Sam Howell for UNC is coming in at number 4, and then Raheem Blackshear for Virginia Tech is 5th. So a couple new additions and the same running backs at the top that are still leading the Heisman race. We can see here the awards finalists. This is not final yet. This is still yet to play out, but you can see the guys at the top here. Malik Davis is leading for the Walter Camp Award. Tariq Barnes. Tariq Barnes leading for the Bednarik Trophy. The Nagurski Tariq Barnes is also second. That is the Defensive Player of the Year. Owen Papo for Auburn is leading right now. But you can see Tariq Barnes and also Jamal Woods is on there as well. The top three are the ones that end up being the finalists. The O'Brien Award, Keaton Thompson is neck and neck with Sam Howell. The Doak Walker Award for the Best Running Back. Look at that. Mike Epstein is number 9. I was hoping to see Epstein on this list, and there he is. He is more than deserving to be on this list. I was hoping that he'd be at least top 5 or top 3 so that he could be a finalist, but Mike Epstein still has a little bit of work to do, and I'm glad to see him on that list for best running backs in the country. De'Ami Brown for North Carolina is the leader right now in the Biletnikoff. The Mackey, Kyle Pitts. The best tight end in the country is the leader right now for the Mackey. The Outland Trophy, Tyler Linderbaum, the center for Iowa. Iowa always seems to have great offensive lines. He is the leader for that, as well as the Remington Award with Creed Humphrey from OU just behind him. The Lombardi Award, the best defensive lineman or linebacker in the country. Colby Wooden for Auburn is first, but look at this, a slew of Illini. Keith Randolph, Seth Coleman, and Jamal Woods are all top 5. It's just been an incredible how well this defensive line has performed all season, and it shouldn't be a surprise that Illinois has 3 guys that are finalists for the Lombardi Award. And look at that, Tariq Barnes is second again behind Owen Papo for best linebacker. Everything is well deserved. A lot of guys on defense have really stepped up this year, especially in the last 3 games. The defense has been playing well. And Jartavius Martin is 6th in the Jim Thorpe Award, along with Eddie Smith. Jim Thorpe is the best secondary player in the country, certainly well-deserving as well. And then the Lou Groza Award for the best kicker. Caleb Griffin is number 5. Caleb Griffin has just been solid all year long. He's 14 of 15 on the year. He's hit all of his extra points. He's been rock solid. Michael Turk from Arizona State is the leader for the Ray Guy Award. And then this is what I was hoping to see. Kyron Cumbie, the leader, and the leader by far, by a mile, for the best returner in the country. He has over 1,500 kick return yards and 3 touchdowns. That is just blowing everyone else out of the water. He's already got that award locked up. And just a quick little look here at the bowl projections. You can see Illinois right now is projected to go to the Duke's Mayo Bowl against Miami. That would be a fun, interesting matchup there. Of course, this is not final. This is just a projection. These always change, and they change very quickly, especially late into the season. But that would be an outstanding bowl for Illinois to be in, and certainly a fun matchup against Miami. So this will just to give you a little idea of where Illinois stands right now. All right, guys, that'll do it for today's episode. I hope you guys enjoyed all that. We covered a lot. And next week, we will turn the page and look forward to week 11. The Illinois will be going on the road to face Minnesota in Minneapolis. Minnesota is a 6-point favorite over Illinois. I know Illinois is ranked number 16, but Illinois will be the underdog in this game. You can see here, Minnesota's been putting up a good amount of points per game. They're number 22 in points per game in the country. Very solid total offense, number 23. They like to pass the ball a lot, very similar to Purdue and Iowa. So they're not anything different than what Illinois has seen all year. Number 7 in passing offense in the country. They're not good at rushing the ball. And defensively, Minnesota certainly had their struggles this season. And we'll take a look here at their schedule. I mentioned in a few episodes ago how Minnesota was kind of getting a little unlucky this year, losing a ton of really close games to good teams. And you can see here that their only bad loss was to Nebraska on the road, who's a very good team. But they've lost to some solid teams by very few points, and they've won the games that they should win. So that's why Minnesota's a 6-point favorite over Illinois. They are a lot better than what their record says. Look at Tanner Morgan's stats. Their quarterback, he's thrown for over 2,500 yards, 23 touchdowns, only 3 interceptions. That is very good. There's a reason why he was preseason first team all Big Ten. Trayson Potts is their running back. And then Rashad Bateman, another star wide receiver that's in this conference. 8 touchdowns on the year. Or he averages 134 yards per game. So we'll be looking forward to that game. Illinois will be going to TCF Bank Stadium in Minneapolis. And this will be a tough game. I don't think this will be a game that Illinois will be blowing out Minnesota by any means. Minnesota is favored over Illinois for a reason. They're a very solid team, and I think Illinois will have their hands full. I think this will be a very solid competitive game. So I hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and we'll be looking forward to next week as we go back into the game videos to face Minnesota. See you guys then.